Welcome back to our introduction to OpenMP in small bytes. My name is Christian Terboven from RWTH Aachen University. In today's video, I'm going to talk about task scheduling, which continues our introduction to tasking in OpenMP. So I said that the OpenMP runtime is responsible to schedule the tasks. That means to decide which thread is going to execute which task at what point in time. There are some restrictions that are enabled by default as to which thread can execute which tasks. So by default, the task is tied to the thread that first executes this task. That means it's not necessarily the creator. So these are words that are not present in the OpenMP specification, but I'd like to use them to explain how task scheduling works. So there's a creator and there's an executor. And these are words that intend to refer to two threads. So that means there's one thread that encounters the pragma-omp task construct, for example, which creates a thread and, according to my model, might execute it immediately or put it into a work queue. If that thread is executed immediately, then this creator thread is also the executor thread. If the task is put into the work queue for deferred execution, then still it could be that this creator thread is actually the thread that will a little bit later pick up the task from the work queue and execute it. But it could also be a different thread. So the thread that creates a task is not necessarily the thread that actually executes it. However, by default, tasks are tied, so that means if a certain thread has picked up the task for execution, it will execute this task to the very end. When or how might the task execution be interrupted? So there are so-called task scheduling points, and I've listed three, or technically five, here on this slide. So a task scheduling point is the creation of a task and the finish of a task. And if you think that a task might contain other tasks, technically, if there's an inner task, the outer task is suspended, then the inner task might be executed or put onto the work queue. And sooner or later, the outer task will be continued. And in the default case, a tied task means the thread that starts to execute the task will also finish the task execution after the task might have been suspended at the task scheduling point. The task wait is also a task scheduling point, similar to the barrier, process synchronization constructs. And there's a task yield. This is a construct that we will take a look at in a minute or so. There are also untied tasks in OpenMP. This is enabled by adding the clause untied to the pragma-omp task construct or any other task generating construct. And that means a task might be suspended, and then when it's resumed, this might be done by a different thread. Again, it's not required to be a different thread, but it could be only if you put in the untied clause. There's this one sentence that is striked out. It reads, there are no scheduling restrictions with untied tasks. That means it might be suspended at any point. So this is actually something that was written in the OpenMP specification, and I believe in version 3 when tasking was introduced. However, this is not possible to be implemented because a task might do some or might consume some operating system services, some third-party libraries, and so forth. And in there, it can't. Or there are certain situations in which it cannot be suspended. So that means later versions of OpenMP have corrected that, and tasks can only be suspended at so-called task scheduling points. What is the idea of an untied clause? That means, when is it useful? Well, it gives a runtime a little bit more free implementation to perform load balancing by switching the threads that execute the task. So if we have one task that generates many other tasks. Yeah? And if that task is tied, there's only one thread that's able to execute this task. If this special thread is then blocked by other operations, for example, another long-running task, I/O operations, and so forth, there's no thread that is allowed to continue generating more tasks. So that means, in the worst of all cases, all the other threads run empty. If the runtime detects such a situation, it doesn't actively have to detect that actively. Instead, task stealing could just be employed. Yeah? This could improve the program execution performance by making sure that there's always tasks being created. However, that would require, in the situation that I've just described, that another thread continue the execution of a suspended task, namely this task that's responsible to generate more work, meaning more tasks. And this is only allowed if the untied clause is given. Does this work in practice? To be honest, I've seen at the time of recording this video, end of 2020, only very few applications, OpenMP runtimes making use of that clause, and then only in some special cases. However, it's a clause that's in OpenMP, and with implementations becoming more and more mature, full-featured, and robust, and so forth, we say we improve the quality of the implementation. At some point, the untied clause might make a difference even for your application. I said there's the untied construct in OpenMP. And I explained that it has the untied clause, and that it's not the default. That's what I wanted to say. So why is that? It can lead to a problem that, as a programmer, you're not aware of. So because untied tasks might migrate between threads, so that means threads can change, or the thread ID, that means the underlying system thread that's executing a task might change, not necessarily at any point, but at so-called task switching points. Any thread-centric constructs can yield, let me call it, unexpected results or even wrong results. So that means if you have an untied task, you have to avoid thread private variables, because between setting it and reading it later on, the thread might have changed, and in consequence, the value might be gone or uninitialized or something like that. Avoid the use of thread IDs in general. So for example, if you would read OMP get thread num at the beginning of the task, at a later point in time, that value might have changed if there has been a task scheduling point in between. And similarly, several synchronization constructs are limited to a certain thread. And if you would use that in OpenMP untied tasks, then you would violate their usage contract. If you need a so-called tight region within an untied task, you can create another task, pragma-op task, with if zero or if false. That means that there will be a tight task within an untied task, or that would lead could lead to a tied task within an untied task that is not allowed to be deferred. That means if the if expression evaluates to false, it will execute it immediately. And in there, you could make use of any constructs that require a thread ID to be persistent during the execution of this task region. However, if you have anything like that, I would recommend to avoid using untied at all. Two slides ago, I mentioned the task yield directive, and I would like to give you an overview about what that is. But however, let me add this word of warning. Again, this is something that only very few OpenMP runtimes actively exploit. But I hope this will change in the future. So the task yield directive specifies that the current task can be suspended in favor of executing a different task. So the current task or thread executing a task that encounters a task yield is allowed, not required to, it's allowed to put the current task to sleep, that means back into the task queue or work queue, take another task, execute the other task, and at some point later come back to the task yield and continue the execution of the original task afterwards. By default, if it's a tied task, then this will be the same thread, meaning the executor. In an untied task, it could be a different thread. When is this useful? It could be a hint to the runtime for optimization and maybe also for deadlock prevention. So for deadlock prevention, only if you use other constructs like logs and so forth, or in general synchronization constructs, that could lead to a deadlock. Yeah? But it could allow the runtime to perform some optimizations. Let me try to illustrate that with an example. Here, this OpenMP code consists of basically only two functions. These are called do something useful and do something critical, or forget the do, something useful and something critical. These are called within a function named foo, which makes use of a log. And you just have to assume that out there, there's some kind of OpenMP parallel region and so forth. So we are within a parallel execution, and then this task is encountered. And this task is encountered in an I loop, so that means n of these tasks are being generated. Each task will do something useful. Something useful might be a long-running, meaning work-intensive or compute-intensive operation. At some point, the work is completed. Then the idea is that the result, or the underlying idea behind this example, is that the result might be written back to a shared state or something like that. And this is what is done in something critical. Something critical is something that has to be executed only when the lock has been acquired, because it's critical. It's a critical region, critical section or something like that, because it modifies the shared state. What is this code doing here? It's making use of the OpenMP lock API. If you know locks, that's probably straightforward to understand. However, in this OpenMP course, we didn't cover locks in detail so far. So this code tries to acquire a lock, OpenMP test lock, which tries to acquire the lock. If it does, that's good. If it doesn't, it returns false. Yeah? And this is done in a while loop, so it doesn't block until it requires gets a lock. Instead, if the lock cannot be taken, yeah, the body of the while loop will be executed because of the negation here. So instead of doing a spin wait to acquire the lock, which could lead to a performance drop down, and in the worst of all cases, even to a deadlock if all threads would try to acquire the lock or task while one is not making progress because of any other reason. So instead of doing the spin lock, Pragma OMP task yield is encountered. And that means the thread executing this task can suspend this task, do something else, for example, do something useful in a different task. And at some point it will return back, again, ask OMP test lock, and if it's then successful, perform the something critical, release a lock, and then the task is completed. So this is not a very general scenario, it's a specific scenario. But if there are certain operations that might not be executed because a lock has not been taken or because IO operations have to be completed, it might make sense to give the OpenMP runtime the opportunity to suspend the execution of a given task. And this is what the task yield directive is for. So the waiting task might be suspended here, allow the executing thread to perform other work. In this concrete example, execute the something useful in a different task and come back later on. It may or may not avoid deadlock situations. So let me add a remark here. Task yield is not guaranteed to actually make the thread switch the task. So it's a hint to the runtime. If you rely on task yield to work to avoid a deadlock, then you're violating the rules of the OpenMP standard, because task yield could be technically implemented as a no-op. So I probably have to make the slide more concrete, but I would advise you to only make use of task yield for performance reasons and not for correctness reasons. Finally, when it comes to task scheduling, in this introduction to OpenMP, I would like to give you a brief outlook onto task and dependencies. And I hope to continue recording videos in the future so that we can cover more advanced topics where we would go into more detail also on task and dependencies. So what is a task dependency? think of, or you can probably think of certain scenarios where individual tasks have to be executed, but in a certain order. And that means there are dependencies between these tasks. So far, by looking at OpenMP tasks, tasks were generated and then executed. And possibly, if there are enough threads are available, the task could be executed in parallel. However, sometimes for the sake of correctness, this would not be possible. And this is where task dependencies come into play, because with that you can enforce an ordering on the execution of tasks. We try to come up with an example here that we are also using in our lectures, and this is the example of building a house. If you build a house, and if you did so, you know that from your own experience, there are certain things that have to be done in order. We selected only 7 very simple tasks here, but I hope they can illustrate what I'm trying to say. Before you start any of the actual house construction work, you have to do the landscaping. Otherwise, you can't start. Then you have to build the walls. After, however, the walls have been built, there's some degree for parallelism. So if the walls have been built, you can start putting up the roof. If the walls are there, you can, in the inside, start with the electrical installation. And if the walls are there, you can technically start with the exterior siding. However, you can't start with shingling the roof before you have put up the roof. So again, there's an order. But these three kind of bubbles here, this one, and this one, can be continued in parallel, meaning simultaneously, after the initial build, the walls has been completed, and that's only possible after the landscaping has been done. And I guess I'm missing an error here. So what I'm trying to say is there might be dependencies between the tasks, but that doesn't mean that all the tasks have to be executed in one very specific order, and by no means one after each other. But we might have different degrees of freedom. Dependencies are more than synchronization constructs, and this is what I would like to illustrate on this slide here. So we learned so far about task weight, which is clearly a synchronization construct, but dependencies are more fine-grained. So let's take a look at the example first on the left-hand side, which uses traditional task weight, and then the example on the right-hand side, which has been rewritten to achieve more or less the same, but with dependencies. So traditional task weight, here we have a parallel single, one task that writes out X, a task weight, another task that increments X. So clearly this task can only be executed after the first one has been completed, because otherwise we would have a race condition on the variable of X. So we need a synchronization construct in between or a dependency. In this particular example, we just have to execute one task after another. So the task weight might actually be good enough. But in other applications, the downside of a task weight might be that it waits for all the tasks or the children tasks that have been generated before. And this is what I'm trying to see to illustrate here with this kind of a barrier-like thing. So the task weight might induce a stronger synchronization than what is actually necessary for your application. And this can be resolved with dependencies. So here we are saying pragma-omp tasks depend in, pragma-omp tasks depend in out. And they both use the variable x as a dependency variable. So what are in and in out dependencies? Because of this being a simple introduction, I don't have details here. As I said, we would like to continue like that in the future, but I would like to give you the idea. The idea behind task dependencies is to take a look at the data flow. And data can either be read, which means it's consumed, for which this depend in stands for, or it can be written, that means modified, that means a value is provided. This is what the out dependency supports. However, out and in out in OpenMP are equivalent. So this is why we have depend in out on this slide. So the variable here is being written, is being read and written. So let's take a look at the source code here. So the variable x is read. Yeah, that means within the task, so the value is being written to the command line. And in this task, the variable x is being read, one is added, and then the value has been updated. So this is why it's an in, out. And then there's a rule that if we have multiple tasks that are ready for execution with an independency on the same variable, they can be executed in parallel. Why is that? Because the variable is only being consumed, it's not being modified. If then there's a task generated with an in-out dependency, or just an out dependency which is equivalent, on the same variable, all the previous tasks have to be completed before the in-out task is allowed to be executed. Why? Because the variable is read, but it's also modified. That means there's an update done to the variable. And again, if then a previously generated task with an in variable, sorry, an independence would be executed, we would have a race condition. So think of the data flow. Multiple tasks just consuming a variable can be executed, but then if there is one or more tasks with an in-out dependency, they have to be completed before the in-out task is allowed to be executed. Similarly, other tasks with in-out dependencies can't be executed at the same time. And if there are any independency tasks on the same variable generated afterwards, again, they can only be started after the tasks with the in-out dependency have been completed because the modifications of the variable have to be done. Think of the data flow. This is what the task dependencies in OpenMP try to express. And I hope this gives you a rough overview. So although I don't have a code example here, the idea is that in the traditional task wait, yeah, if we would execute this code twice, we would have a task wait here. So that means the second task has to be executed before then again the first task in the second instance can be executed. If we look at dependencies, yeah, you can see that we don't have the strict barrier-like synchronization construct here because tasks that do not depend on each other with respect to the data flow can be executed simultaneously. So with task dependencies, we can express more fine-grained synchronization than with synchronization constructs.